Hello, my name is Albert Barrocas. I am a retired surgeon, general, non-cardiac thoracic, vascular, and a very avid nutrition support physician since the early 80s, and actually starting in 1977. Today we're going to talk about ethics in nutrition support, what I refer to as old wine in new bottles. Ethics is influenced by the law, and is influenced by technology. And so over the years, I've developed the concept of the troubling trichotomy. That is, what can be done technologically, what should be done ethically, and what must be done by the law. All three are not necessarily in concert, and at times creates conflict. In terms of technology, we have learned over the last five decades or so that we have gone from TPN development, which now we refer to as PN, parenteral nutrition, from the days that were introduced in 1968-69 by Dudrick and Associates at the University of Pennsylvania, to now where we're discussing microbiomes and probiotics, as well as artificial intelligence. These are developments that will have and will probably change the way we do business in the future. And as a matter of fact, it was Albert Einstein who said that I fear the day that technology will surpass our human interactions and the world will have a generation of idiots. When we talk about morals and ethics, a lot of time the two are interchanged and overlap. Morals deals mostly with the standards of right or wrong behavior, while ethics are more like the rules. And I see it more as one being a policy, that is the morals, and then the execution of those morals through the procedures, which are ethics. There are about three or four ethical theories, virtue, duty, and utilitarianism, that you can relate to for your background information. But in reality, since the late 70s, what we have in the Western society and in the U.S. relied upon are the four principles that are part of the ethical approach based on those theories. And they include autonomy, which is self-determination, beneficence, which is acting in the best interest of the patient, non-maleficence, first doing no harm, or the so-called primum non nocere, and then distributive justice. I think that as we deal not only with our patients but with each other, it's important that we remember those facets who are equally weighed, but yet at times they could conflict, so that the autonomy can be superseded at times by the distributive justice. That is, the interests of the state or the community at large can override the individual mandate. Now, this in part became an issue during COVID-19, particularly in the early parts when we were afraid that we would not have enough equipment or resources. And I think that it's important to have a priori protocols dealing with limited resources, whether supply, capacity, or personnel, and at the same time have these ahead of time to avoid a lot of conflict. To develop those protocols, it's necessary to have an ethical framework, and at the same time, once the protocols are developed, to have a triage team that will execute on those protocols, but without the participation of the clinical team or ethics committees, although those two bodies can provide input as the triage team makes their decision. The benefits should be maximized. Priority to healthcare workers and others should be given since they're in the front lines. There should be random allocation for patients and similar prognosis. And then different prioritization per intervention may arise in response to changing scientific evidence. There should not be any differentiation in allocating resources between patients with COVID-19 and those with other medical conditions such as COPD. And more importantly, there is a potential for objective measurement by using a reduced short-term mortality scoring and an increased long-term survival. For the reduced short-term mortality, one can use the Apache or SOFA scores and score from 1 to 4. And for the increased long-term survival, a number 2 is assigned to those with comorbidities, while those that have an expectancy of less than a year are given a score of 4. Once the total is tallied, this provides a number, the lower number, indicating the best chance for survival and therefore higher on the list of priorities for receiving resource allocation. As it relates to end of life, I think it's important that we recognize that there's little difference between withholding and withdrawing therapies, although the withdrawing is more emotionally laden. And I think that we need to realize that we can do either, so long as we communicate effectively with the family and patients and provide them with accurate information through evidence-based medicine. As it relates to advanced directives, I think it is important for all health professionals to assure that the directives are reviewed, that they have them on hand, and that they have been updated, and that we know who the surrogate decision maker is, and that they are vetted appropriately. Otherwise, we may have difficulties at the last minute. And again, all recommendations should be based on evidence-based medicine. Advanced dementia brings us to a different scenario where we have the difference between competence, which is usually a legal term, and decisional capacity, which is a clinical one. We all can have decisional capacity interrupted by narcotics, or if we're going to have surgery, general anesthesia, etc. And at the same time, decisional capacity can be total or partial. So we may have an individual that is totally incapable of making decisions, while others, despite the fact that they have advanced dementia, may be able to deal with healthcare decisions, but not necessarily their finances. And then we have the individuals that in the past were referred to as permanent vegetative state, now known as minimally conscious states, MCS. And for those, the question is how permanent are these disabilities? Since in the past there have been some breakthroughs where individuals that have been in long-term comas, for instance, were able to return to some type of mentation. And so it is important and incumbent upon us to identify the exact way that the diagnosis was determined, you know, how permanent. And then the question comes as to whether or not to be or not to be. And as we talk about PEG tubes, I like to use the term PEG to state, please explain the goals. I think there are a lot of resources, such as Choosing Wiley from the American Board of Internal Medicine, which provides these very handy family and patient educational pieces, such as feeding tubes for people with Alzheimer's, and then to consider time-limited trials that provide an ability for us to at least try a therapy, so long as we know that clinically, when we no longer see a benefit, that we will withdraw it without the family necessarily being involved at that juncture. The same thing has to do with individuals that already have a tube, not to remove them until we have everything documented well and all parties concerned are in agreement. Otherwise, we'll experience what others have in the national news with the tube being removed, reinserted, et cetera, back and forth. I think it's incumbent on all of us to reach out beyond just nutrition support and consider that we're part of the larger community. And for that, we need to look at human rights, and it's currently there's an ongoing effort to establish human nutritional care as a human right. That is being spearheaded by Diana Cardenas. There are two excellent articles that have been published on this, among others, an NCP and nutrition and clinical nutrition, because nutritional care is at the intersection of the right to food and the right to health that was developed in 1948 by the United Nations. Now we need to blend them together and provide a human right for nutritional care that encompasses screening, assessment, diagnosis, therapy, and follow-up treatment. And to that goal, we have an international working group that is represented by six of the major federations or societies, ASPEN, ESPEN, PELAMPE, PENSAS, ASPEN, and WASPEN. And that group is providing the principles or core values that include fairness, respect, equality, dignity, and autonomy, also known as the FREDA principles, that are the basis for what is going to be the International Declaration on the Human Right to Nutritional Care to be presented in Vienna during the ESPEN meeting in September 2022. And we are asking more nutrition societies and others to join us in that effort. To me, dietitians in particular represent individuals who need to be very ethically involved in all aspects of healthcare, and also that they provide the type of knowledge and commitment to the profession beyond nutrition, and participate in ethics committees, participate in value assessment, in quality improvement activities. The ideal dietitian to me is one that's dedicated, intelligent, experienced and ethical, team member, informative, tenacious, inquisitive, always committed and nurturing. And they need to be well versed on how to provide value, that is the outcomes divided by the cost, either by improving the outcomes, by reducing the cost, or both. Their function in teams, whether it's the nutrition support teams or other healthcare teams, where they bring the expertise of their profession, we need to recognize that we have moved from multidisciplinary to interdisciplinary, and currently, because many are assuming other roles that are within the scope of their type of practice, transdisciplinary, that is cross-functioning. In some cases, we have dietitians inserting nasenteric tubes. In others, we have dietitians that are able to provide TPN coverage. I think it's important to remember that there's no I in team, but also there's no success without you. It's also important when we sit at the table that in order to be understood, we first must seek to understand. Because if we're not at the table, you may be on the menu. And this, in particular, was highlighted by a recent article by Denise Schwartz, who said that the role of the nutrition support dietitian on a bioethics committee is quite important. And I urge all of you to try to request being on the ethics committee of your particular hospital. Approaching your patient then requires not only a dedication to ethics, but common sense. I call it the 12 C's: common sense, common decency, competence, commitment, communications, consultation, collaboration, coordination, concern, consent, consensus, care, compassion, and comfort. And lastly, comfort is important because it's part of the basis of our goals of healthcare professionals: to cure sometimes, treat often, and comfort always. I thank you for your time, and please feel free to contact me if you have any questions whatsoever.